Doing? You good? Water. Water. This is water. That's exactly right. Now, got a question for you. Why do I have a bowl of water here?
Because you baptize people with water.
We do baptize people with water. This water is not for baptizing, though. For drinking? Well, I could drink it, right? Huh? I am thirsty. I get thirsty a lot. How about you? Do you get thirsty a lot? No? No? You get hungry a lot. You get thirsty?
A lot.
A lot. Okay. All right. Well, this water isn't here for drinking, okay? But it is a reminder of baptism, okay? And so when we are baptized, do you know what happens when we're baptized? Because we got some people getting baptized that you get wet. You do get wet. Pastor pours water. So I just like that? Huh? Oh. Okay. Yeah. So when we baptize, we put water on the head. Why would we do that? Why would I pour water on your head and say, you're baptized?
Whoosh.
That is actually very good. You take a bath, you got to get your hair washed because there's dirt in it. That's what happens with baptism, okay? See, anytime we do something that God doesn't want us to do, do you know what that's called?
Sin.
That's right. Okay, yes. When our hair gets messy, we clean it. See, I don't have to worry about that anymore, right? My hair never gets dirty because I don't have any. Well, but I just get a little dirty, okay? So what happens with baptism is that we're dirty because of sin, okay? So every time we sin, it's like going into a mud puddle, all right, and getting all covered with dirt. And baptism, all right, is taking that water and we put on us, and God works a miracle in the middle of baptism to wash all that dirt away. Just like you get into a shower or you get in the tub and you wash all the mud off after you've been in the puddle. And you're fresh, sparkling, clean, and you feel good. That's what God does through baptism. And God does that through, he uses water, but it's really the Holy Spirit that comes down upon us and cleanses us from all that sin, all right? And a lot of times that we, in the Methodist Church, we do that when we're first born. And so a lot of times people will get baptized when they're a child, all right? Well, guess what? Even if we're baptized, have you ever done anything wrong?
Yeah.
Well, you shouldn't be answering for her. Okay. Yeah, sometimes we do. Yeah. Even when we're baptized, we sometimes do things wrong, right? Okay. And so God's like, we gotta change some hearts and let them know that they've been made clean, and so they don't have to do that stuff anymore. And so God gives us this gift of the Holy Spirit, all right? And what we do with this water, all right, is, you want to play in it?
No.
What we do with this, all right, is you only get baptized once because God doesn't make mistakes, right? But sometimes we need to remember what God has done in our lives, all right? And so sometimes we want to remember our baptism, so we get some water out there, and we make a sign of a cross and say, remember your baptism and be holy, be clean in your living and in your thinking and in your doing, all right? And so we want to remember, all right? And that's one of the things that's going to happen today with our confirmants, okay? We've got three. Calvin's actually one of them, okay? And he's going to be baptized, and then we're going to remember that baptism, okay, for everybody, all right, so that they remember that God is with them and that we are made clean, all right? And God is with you. And that blessing means that your life gets to change. And you get to become who God wants you to become, all right? And the great thing is, you don't have to do it all by yourself, because God gives you the presence and the power of the Holy Spirit to help you, okay? So let's pray, can we? Dear God, we thank you for making us clean. We thank you for pouring your Holy Spirit down upon us, that all of our sins are washed away, that we are made whole in you and clean and feeling good. And Grace, God, just help us to remember that, okay? To remember that all the time, so that when we live for you and not for all those different things that we want that kind of make us a little messy sometimes. Guide us, God, into being who you want us to be, and help us to always, always, always remember our baptism. When we get a shower, when we drink a glass of water, when we get a bath or go swimming, anytime we have an opportunity to be cleaned, let us remember you and know that our cleaning isn't just something that happens on the outside. Because of you and your Holy Spirit, that cleaning happens on the inside as well. And we're so thankful. Gracious God, go with each of us. In Jesus' name. And all God's children said, amen. Amen. Okay, now. What? All right, you're going to go back and sit with your folks, all right, until after the adult choir. Because we want you to be here when the confirmands, when we have the baptism and when we have the confirmation. So we want you to be a part of that. So when that's all over, you'll have a chance to go with Miss Jamie, okay? So right now, go back to your seats. Yeah, I would go back up with your dad. Okay? Bulletins to the insert, or use the screen. Thank you. seated. So, as we come together now for the privilege of baptism and confirmation of growing the Church of God, I got to tell you, these youth put me through the paces. They were challenging. All right, you had five girls and a guy, and they wouldn't talk to me for the first 2 weeks. And everything went through Cecilia. God bless Cecilia. I don't know, where are you at, Cecilia? Yeah. she is a blessing in working with these youth, and they eventually warmed up to me and then wouldn't stop talking. But be that all as it may. The church is of God, okay, and will be preserved to the end of time for the conduct of worship and the due administration of God's word, the sacraments, and the maintenance of church fellowship and discipline, and for the edification of believers and the conversion of the world. All of every age and station and stand in the need of the means of grace, which it alone supplies. All right. For as much as all of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, our Savior Christ said, unless one is born of water and the Spirit, one cannot enter into the kingdom of God. So I invite you to pray with me. Almighty and everlasting God, we call upon thee for these thy servants, that they, coming to thy holy baptism, may receive remission of their sins and be filled with the Holy Spirit. Receive them, O Lord, as thou hast promised by thy well-beloved Son, and grant that they may be faithful to thee all the days of their lives, and finally come to the eternal kingdom which thou hast promised through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. All right, confirmants, come on down. Let's just line you up right here. What's that? You came from everywhere. That's the way it should be. All right, all right. We're missing one. Oh, here she comes. All right, so here are the questions, all right? And remember, if I start a question with do, you say I do, right? It's like getting married, all right? You're getting married to the church, all right? All right, so ready for this? All right. Do you, in the presence of God and this congregation, renew the solemn vow and promise that is made for three of you at your baptism, and for three of you is going to be made at your baptism? I do. All right. Let's show a little excitement with that I do. Let's try that again. All right. Do you, in presence of God in this congregation, renew the solemn vows and promise made at your baptism? All right, there we go. All right. Now, do you truly and earnestly repent of your sin?
I do.
All right. You guys can all join in this, all right? Do you believe in God the Father?
I do.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. You guys can watch the screen. It'll be there.
I forgot there was one up there.
Yeah, okay. All right. Do you believe in Jesus Christ? I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe in the Holy Spirit? I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Do you receive and profess the Christian faith as contained in the scriptures of the Old and New Testament?
I do.
Okay. Do you promise, according to the grace given you, to keep God's holy will and commandments and walk all the same of your days as faithful members of Christ's holy church?
I do.
Okay. All right. All right. So, there's a little bit of tentativeness there. We're good? All right. All right. Calvin, you're up. Step over. All right. Would Calvin's parents want to come on down? Go ahead. Yep. Just go ahead and kneel right here. Just on either side's fine. You ready for this? Do you want a towel? Because I'm going to empty the whole thing on you. No, I'm kidding, just in case. All right. If you want to lay your hands on him. Calvin, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. May God bless you and enrich you as you live your life for him. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. All right. Go ahead and step over. Next. Come on, Sammy. Parents. Now, you wanted more water, right? Samantha, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. May God bless you and confirm you as you live your life for him. Go and serve Jesus in all you do in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And all God's people said, amen. Come on down, Carly. You ready? Carly, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. May God bless you and enrich you as you give your life to him. May you serve him with glory and grace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and all God's people said, amen. Amen. Okay. You can stand here. All right. Now it's for the rest of you, getting them all in here. All right. So, you ready?
Yeah.
All right. Okay. Emma's, come on down. Ready? Emma, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, I invite you to remember your baptism. May the Lord defend you with his heavenly grace and by his Holy Spirit confirm you in faith and fellowship of all true disciples of Jesus Christ. Amen. Okay. Go ahead. Come on. Emily, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, I invite you to remember your baptism. May the Lord defend you with his heavenly grace and by his Spirit confirm you in the faith and the fellowship of all true disciples of Jesus Christ. Amen. Penny, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, I invite you to remember your baptism. May the Lord defend you with his heavenly grace, and by his Spirit confirm you in the faith and the fellowship of all true disciples of Jesus Christ. Amen. Remember that baptism we did just a minute ago? It's hard, right? So we're going to invite you to remember it. Calvin, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, I invite you to remember your baptism. May God confirm you in faith and fellowship of all true disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ. May he defend you with his heavenly grace. Amen. Carly, you remember that baptism we just did? Okay. All right. Well, I'm going to invite you to remember it again. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, remember your baptism. And may the Lord defend you with his heavenly grace and by his Holy Spirit confirm you in the faith and the fellowship of all true disciples of Jesus Christ. Amen. Do you remember? No? Okay, well, that's good, because now you can. So, Sammy, I invite you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit to remember your baptism. May the Lord defend you with his heavenly grace and by his Spirit confirm you in the faith and the fellowship of all true disciples of Jesus Christ. Amen. All right. I invite you all to turn and don't be going away. You can just, okay, well, turn and face them. Turn. Now see that? You're covering up the people behind you. So slide to the side there. I have to give somebody some abuse. All right. Not that much abuse. Folks, this is your 2024 confirmation class. May God bless them and nourish them, enrich them, and allow them to celebrate their life in Christ and as their family in faith. Let us celebrate with them. I invite you to welcome them into the church. So where's Emma? Down here. Okay, and Calvin. Emily. And Samantha. Penny? And Carly. Be blessed, folks. You can go sit down now. All right.
And there has been beauty these eyes have seen. But it was in the night, through the storms of my life. Oh, that's where God proved his love to me.
Now hear the word of God from the New Testament, Romans 8, verses 26 through 28. In the same way the Spirit helps us in our weakness, we do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us through wordless groans. And he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. And we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you. So today is a day that's filled with expectations. It's actually a wonderful day. We've got six youth who have made a commitment to Christ and to this church. They've accepted the freedom and the power God gives them to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they encounter them. They've confessed Jesus Christ as their Savior and placed all of their trust in his grace, promised to serve him as Lord of their lives. And together with the rest of us as the church, they've said they're going to welcome people of all ages, nations, and races. They've promised, with God's help, with God's gracious help, to be faithful to Christ's holy church and to serve as Christ's representatives in the world. It's a good day. And I fully expect them to live up to their word. Okay? Of course, I fully expect the rest of you to live up to your word as well. And if you remember, you just made promises too. You promised to surround these youth with a community of love and forgiveness so that they will continue to grow in faith and continue to grow in service. You promised to pray for them so that they will become true disciples, meaning that while they may still have a lot to learn about how best to live into the faith that they are proclaiming, it's your responsibility to help them. Every one of us who've taken vows of membership in the United Methodist Church have stood up and promised to be loyal to Christ through the United Methodist Church and do everything in our power to strengthen its ministry. We have promised to faithfully participate in the work of the church with our prayers, with our presence, with our gifts, with our service, and with our witness. Even more, every one of us who claim the name Christian, we've identified ourselves as people who promise to reflect the love of Jesus Christ with every thought, with every word, with every deed that we offer. There are no exemptions. We've created some pretty hefty expectations. Expectations for the direction that our lives are going to go, expectations on how we are going to treat others inside and outside of our spheres of influence, expectations for God, and expectations from God. And again, these expectations, they're pretty serious and pretty sizable. So as Christians, how do we deal with all of this? There's a fellow by the name of Daniel Boorstin. Daniel Boorstin suggests that Americans suffer from all too extravagant expectations. And in his much quoted book, The Image, Boorstin, who is a historian, he makes this observation of Americans. He says, "We expect anything and everything. We expect the contradictory and the impossible. We expect compact cars to be spacious and luxury cars to be economical. We expect to be rich and charitable, powerful and merciful, kind and competitive. We expect to eat and stay thin, to be constantly on the move and ever more neighborly. We expect to go to the church of our choice and feel its guiding power over us. We expect to revere God and to be God." Boorstin says, "Never have people been so much more the masters of their environment, and yet never has people felt more deceived and disappointed, because never has a people expected so much more than the world could offer." We all have expectations, right? High expectations. In many ways, it's our expectations that make the world go round. Now, thinking back to Boorstin and his examples, those same expectations can cause some chafing in our lives, because all too often, we can't live up to the prospect before us. We can't meet our own expectations, let alone someone else's. And that's the problem with our faith journey. We have this notion of faithfulness that we can't hope to live into. And some simply give up. They give up because the expectations of faith just seem way too unrealistic. They know they can't be who God wants them to be, and so why try? And they'll pray real hard, and they'll lean real heavily on the idea that God is more forgiving than they are committed. Or they'll double down on obedience to the point of allowing no room for fault and failure from themselves or from others, and then all the joy is just sucked out of life because of the intensity required to achieve perfection, a perfection that they don't honestly believe is possible. Well, dare I say that perfection isn't possible. Not because it literally isn't possible. We fail because we may not be as anchored in Christ as we like to think or we like to say we are. Here's what I mean. Practically speaking, our expectations are this intricate mixture of hope and grace coming together by the virtue of the Holy Spirit in union with our heart, our mind, and we're out there seeking God in worship and looking to serve God with gratitude. And you can expect that satisfaction comes through Jesus Christ. However, when we aren't anchored in Jesus, or when we don't have enough scope, enough rope to handle those rough waters that we encounter in our journey with Jesus, our lives remain unsatisfied. Because outside of a total commitment to Jesus, we struggle with faithfulness. I mean, it's true, right? Anybody here ever struggle with their faithfulness? I mean, we may be on the path to perfection, but we haven't arrived. At least I haven't. Total trust in Jesus, however, is essential to anyone's faith journey. First and foremost, faithfulness is built on a foundation of trust. And trust doesn't come easily. That's where our struggle starts. We still want to trust ourselves instead of God. We've been taught self-reliance for all too long. I know better than you, or at very least, I know what's best for me. That's the whole premise behind life coaching, and I'm a strong advocate for life coaching. But it says that we are the best experts on our own lives. And you know what? There's just enough truth to that to inhibit our faith journey if we're not careful. And that kind of puts us between a rock and a hard place as Christians. Our first scripture lesson this morning teaches us all about that. And that was Proverbs 3, verses 5 and 6, okay? And we're just going to look at Proverbs 3, verse 5. So if you have a Bible and you want to open it or just check out the screen. But it says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In other words, God is the best expert on our lives, and we do well to remember that. I want you to think about Sennacherib's attack on Jerusalem back in 701 BC. It's reported in 2 Kings chapter 18 and 19. You can check that story out later. But if you're not familiar with Sennacherib, he was the Assyrian king back in the days of Judah's King Hezekiah. All right? And facing destruction from the Assyrian Empire, Hezekiah aligned Judah with Egypt and Philistia to thwart Assyria. And that alignment failed miserably. Okay? And the end result was that Hezekiah was basically in his own city with the Assyrian army surrounding Jerusalem and giving him a whole lot of grief. And Hezekiah's people were beginning to be taken into slavery, and Sennacherib called with an ultimatum. And Hezekiah could either surrender or suffer the consequences. And the only conclusion that made any sense was for Hezekiah to comply or die. Or trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. Now, if you go back to 2 Kings 18, verses 5 through 7, it will tell you this. Hezekiah trusted in the Lord, the God of Israel. There was no one like him among the kings of Judah, either before him or after him. He held fast to the Lord and did not stop following him. He kept the commands the Lord had given Moses, and the Lord was with him. He was successful in whatever he undertook. He rebelled against the king of Assyria and did not serve him. He rebelled against the king of Assyria and did not serve him. The Assyrian army was around Jerusalem. Was Hezekiah stressed out? You better believe he was stressed out. When the outlook was the darkest for Judah, chapter 19, verse 1 says that Hezekiah, he heard what was happening. He tore his clothes and put on sackcloth and went into the temple of the Lord. He's a little stressed. And while he was in the temple of the Lord, verses 6 and 7 tell us that God came to him and said, listen, when he, meaning Sennacherib, hears a certain report, I will make him want to return to his own country, and there I will have him cut down with the sword. And here's where the verse from our Proverbs 3, verse 6 passage finishes up. In all your ways, submit to him, and he will make your paths straight. We face a lot of stuff in this world. We face untenable circumstances that are overwhelming to consider. You ever found yourself in a can't-win situation more than once? Sometimes those can't-win situations, they're because of our own actions, sometimes our own stupidity, all right? Sometimes it's impressed upon us by others. And we've got to make a lot of diverse decisions, and there's no doubt that our behavior in various activities and situations, without exclusion, those matter. In all your ways, submit to him, and he will make your paths straight. See, our knowledge of God, or lack thereof, is revealed by our responses to divine standards of justice and righteousness. And by all earthly standards, Hezekiah couldn't win. There's no way he was going to beat Assyria. And yet in the end, he didn't flee, he didn't fight, and he certainly didn't lose to the Assyrian army camped outside of his city, telling him and his people that their trust in God was totally misplaced. We won't lose when people tell us that either. Because being anchored in Christ isn't just about knowing the right thing or even doing the right thing. Being anchored in Christ is about being in relationship with God. It's about trusting God to work even when everything screams to you that it can't work. In fact, that's what Paul meant when he said to the Roman church in chapter 8 of the book of Romans that the Spirit helps us in our weakness. And we do not know what we ought to pray for the Spirit himself intercedes for us through wordless groans. And he who searches the heart knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. In other words, Paul realizes that though we are not perfect, the expectation is that we're going on to perfection. And we know that all things work together for good for those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. Paul wants us to know that the Spirit helps us in our weakness. That's refreshing. He realizes that we're in this state of not yet being fully redeemed because there's work to be done in our lives and in the lives of those around us. And those who see hope for holiness fading away, well, they need some help to look into the darkness and pray God's expected future into the here and now. Folks, you got to know that God intends for that day someday when redeemed humanity is in authority over the world, and that we are the agents of change for the rest of the world. However, that power and authority comes only through Jesus, through the presence of the Holy Spirit. That's how it's going to happen. Not by our strength, not by our courage. Problem is that we're weak. Our bodies, for which we have this immediate responsibility, we're subject to decay and death. And so we don't even know what to pray for or how God's going to use us to bring about the redemption of the world. But it's going to happen. And that's precisely why we need to stay anchored in Jesus. He provides us with the Holy Spirit that moves us towards and empowers within us a genuineness of faith that humbly trusts in God so completely that though we may wrestle with God as Jacob did on the shores of Jabbok, we're going to prevail. We're going to be forgiven. We're going to be redeemed. It's what we celebrated this morning. Hope for redemption in the face of futility. And when ruin and misery is coming like a freight train, the only words that escape our lips are this definite or desperate, almost defeated groan. Have you ever felt like that? Just like, ugh, I got to deal with what? Folks, that groan is when the Spirit of God intercedes for us and provides the most articulate, the most beautiful prayer on our behalf to the God of salvation. And it's here that God searches our heart and puts all things right. Here is where we get to sing, "Worthy is the Lamb who was slain." When we are totally vulnerable, totally trusting, totally anchored in Jesus, when we humbly accept that the King of Kings is our everything, that we're going to adore him, well, the author of Lamentations, he hit the nail on the head. The author of Lamentations, in verse 3, verses 24 and 25, says, "I say to myself, the Lord is my portion, therefore I will wait for him. The Lord is good to those whose hope is in him, to the one who seeks him." Folks, today is a good day, a day filled with expectation. The kingdom of God has grown and we get to celebrate. God is so good. Our commitment to Christ and to this church, to accept the freedom and the power God gives us to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves, man, that's the divine order of the day. We have confessed Jesus Christ as our Savior. We've placed our trust in his grace, and we have promised to serve him as Lord of our lives. And together with the rest of the church, we're filled with this awestruck wonder at the mention of his holy name, and we get to welcome people of all ages, of all nations, of all races. Folks, it doesn't get any better than that. But I expect us to live in to our promises. And even more importantly, God expects us to live in to our promises. So let's do that. From this day forward and forevermore, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And all God's people said, Amen. Amen.